Thank you very much for inviting me here, ITM Universe Management. Thank you very much for all of you to be here. We have a limited time, about 20 minutes, to talk about this huge subject, the science behind the needs. And we need to really first understand what the science means, what the needs mean, the two terms, you know, very important for us to understand. And maybe we can pick up some 2, 3, or 4 at the most myths which we can work on. Because I've been working for the last many years on Encyclopedia of Indian Rituals. And we have been closing on that and about almost about 500 rituals. And with a very strong idea that every myth has certain logic and certain science behind it, if we are willing to learn. So let's start with our presentation, because we are all working within a limited time. Can we go to the next slide, please? Understanding the term science is very essential before we discuss the science behind the myths. Science is a window through which we experience, examine, analyze, and assess the event or the phenomenon. Every window has a limit of its own. When windows are widened, the experiences and understanding widens. Something which can't be fitted into a window is not a limitation of the thing or phenomenon, but could be a limitation of a window. So when we look at the sky from our window, the window could be about 16 square feet, 4x4. But that doesn't mean the sky is 16 square feet. The moment you expand the windows to maybe 5x5, you have 25 square feet of sky opening up for you. So somewhere we need to understand science's window, which provides a window, and this window has been expanding for the last many, many years. And so somewhere I think we let us understand what we are looking through to the myths. The second point, let us go to the next slide. Yeah, can we go to the next one? The principles, process, and application. If you look at any science or any subject which is talked about normally, it goes through the three steps. The first is the principles, the second is the process, and the third is applications. And no science of either it is ancient or the modern can really skip this process. Principles are the foundations of any science. They establish a core of a phenomenon. Generally, they operate at a higher level of human consciousness, generally known as an intellect. So we have three basic disciplines that we all follow: intellect, mind, and emotions. Now, these are the different kind of frequencies working with different disciplines of our life. Processes, on the other hand, are in the domain of mind consciousness. When you look at the process is the beginning and process is the end. So it is something which is limited, which our mind can probably connect better. And the last one is applications are closest to human emotions and actions. So this is how we generally go into. And over a period of time, let us see what happens to the principles and the process and applications, so that we set a right kind of a background for understanding what myths and mythologies are all about. Let's go to the next one and understand. Over a period, principles get behind the curtain of human understanding as they're no longer required to be understood. As it is happening today in the mobile, I think 95% of the people or even more probably may not know how the mobile technology works, but they're using mobile anyway. Process is the second one, which stick around for some time before even they go into oblivion as the application dominate human experiences. So one doesn't necessarily know what the process we are following. What remains for a longer time are the applications. This, however, gives an impression that the principles do not exist at all. Over a period of time, now looking back at, forward to 200 years later, probably the people will understand, there's no principle behind the mobiles at all. You know, we get so much dragged into the applications, and probably the same thing might have happened to all the so-called rituals. We call it rituals. The moment it comes to the modern science, we call the prototypes or the protocols rather. See, what we call protocols today are the actual rituals. So let us go to the next one. Most of the myths fall into this category, going to the roots of myths, and give an impression that there are no foundation of logical thoughts at all. Because somewhere the principles and the process both are lost. What has remained in front of us after many, many years and ages, one needs to use the backtracking models to reach out to the roots of such rituals. By crossing over to the boundaries of the time and culture, the scientific mind needs to understand that. So somewhere I think we need to understand it through a mind that we call scientific today. It is very easy to discard certain views as they do not fit within your scheme, but being open to them, experimenting with them, and deciding to accept or reject them based on research could be more scientific effort. I've been seeing lately the scientists and the pseudoscientists are not open to the ideas. The whole idea of science, as I understand, because I am a scientist, and I understand my idea of science was to be open to the nature, open to the various ideas. If the Newton was probably not open to the falling fruit, probably the law of gravitation would never have emerged. If Archimedes was not open to the idea that whatever flows out of the tub is something to do with the specific gravity, probably would have lost these important laws. So somewhere we need to understand that there has to be something like a scientific mind, a logical mind, and everybody has a logical mind. The problem is it is your science versus my science, and that is something which is openness is lost in this science. Most of the time I feel we are discarding a lot of things because they're ancient. Now don't discard them because they're ancient. I think every ancient technology has to be looked into all over again, freshly, tried and experimented, and we can work out whether it is workable or it's not workable. If it's not workable, it has to be thrown out. But if it's workable, it has to be considered seriously as an application to the human life. Next one. Two of the rituals from Vedic times, considered to be the myths by scientific community till last two decades, have already started the revolution in the world around with traditional science still looking with the eyes wide and mouths open. They are yoga and Agnihotra. I've selected these two and maybe another couple of things. And while I was being introduced, a friend talked about the cat crossing the human. And we back out about seven steps behind. And was it only a ritual? Was it something which is an act of stupidity? Or is there something behind that? We are going to address that if the time permits. But let us confine these two, which are actually, you can see, the yoga as well as the Agnihotra, the holy fire. Now, the whole world started laughing at us for the last many, many centuries. And suddenly, everything has turned around for the last 20 years. Yoga, which became a target of mockery by the scientific community in the Western world, which was joined by the pseudoscientists from our own country of India in this act, what's considered to be a twisting and turning of limbs and body, has already started twisting and turning the human understanding about the life in general and the health in particular. Now, I think you know already, for the last about 5-6 years, the yoga has been considered more than about 250 countries all over the world. Hundreds of countries all around the world have already started taking a note of the power of this wonderful ancient technology in balancing the human minds and emotions to curtail the possibilities of emergence of a violent and divided world. Somewhere I think it is the violence, somewhere it is the criminality, somewhere it is the terrorism that we are all going to address about. And something which happens beyond the screen, on the other side of the screen, the inner abilities of humans, and the inner innate personalities of humans. And somewhere the yoga addresses that beautifully. Somewhere we need a calm and composed humanity. Let's go to the next one and see. While yoga opened the possibilities of curtailing the pollution of the inner environment, Agnihotra, another revolutionary phenomenon from the stables of Vedic wisdom, has started proving to be the biggest hope to the world, already panicking about the environment of the planet. Not many people know about that, that actually, truly speaking, we have reached the end of the world as far as the environment is concerned. So somewhere, I think, and the biggest environment pollution today, not many people have been talking about, is radioactive contamination, which has absolutely no solution in the modern science. And there are enough backups on the internet, and I think one looks to look within. One would be surprised to know that today Agnihotra is poised to be the leading technology to curb the menace of radioactive threat to the living communities on this once beautiful planet. And there's enough information probably we can discuss if the time permits at some other time. So let's get into the Agnihotra as a process of the technology and understand more about it, so that we understand the scientific principles behind it. Next one, please. Agnihotra, yeah. Can we go to the next? What is Agnihotra? Now, this one question needs to be addressed. Agnihotra is a process of purification of the atmosphere. It balances the cycle of nature and nourishes the human life. It creates pure, clean, and medicinal environment. It cleanses the negative effect of the problem. And these are the four major issues related to the Agnihotra. First thing is purification of the atmosphere. And when I'm talking about atmosphere, I'm not talking the external atmosphere necessarily. It is inner as well as the outer environment that something Agnihotra addresses. It balances the cycle of nature and nourishes the human life. So somewhere, for the first time, I think people found out around 1984, when there was a Chernobyl accident on the border of Russia and Poland. And there was a huge nuclear holocaust around that time. And that was the time actually Agnihotra was noticed by the scientific communities, almost about 35 years ago. And they realized wherever the Agnihotra has been done, it has worked as an antidote to the nuclear fallout. And that was the first time I think the whole world started looking, and probably today Agnihotra is followed outside India more than probably in India. And it's very popular in the scientific community. It creates pure, clean and medicinal environment, cleanses the negative effect of pollution. Next one, please. Agnihotra is a small fire experiment. What is Agnihotra? Well, the process we are trying to understand the principle and the process is a small fire experiment which is performed every sunset and every sunrise using a small copper pyramid of prescribed size of 5.75 inches and multiplied by 5.75 inches with a height of 5.25 inches. The ingredients to perform this yajna or holy fire are small cakes of cow's dung smeared with cow's ghee and a small portion of full unpolished uncut grains of rice. So basically it has three ingredients: the rice, uncut, unpolished, the raw rice, the cow's dung and the cow's ghee. Yeah, so this with the three things what we can achieve is something phenomenal. Let's go to the next one. Scientific principle, science behind the tools and ingredients used for performing yajna. Why this particular thing? The pot is made of copper, as the copper is acknowledged for its oligodynamic, that is antibacterial action. We all know about copper much more. Metal copper plays an important role in the process of Agnihotra, as Agnihotra has close connection with fire, heat, electromagnetic forces and cosmic energy fields. The word pyramid means fire in the middle, fire plus a mid, it's a Latin word. The pyramid shaped copper pot receives, generates and decentralizes spatial healing and purifying energy in the ecosphere. Its effectiveness reaches peak levels at sunrise and sunset, with which the process of Agnihotra is actually coinciding. So this is something which is a basic process and why we select the copper plot. And this has been mentioned right from the Vedic time that we need to use the copper pot basically for these particular properties of copper. Let's go into and explore what does the cow dung cake really does. Not many people know, I mean, we are talking about B12 deficiencies. The biggest, the richest source of B12 today is the cow dung. And not many people are aware about it. Cow dung contains plenty of menthol, ammonia, phenol, indole, formalin, and specifically its bacteriophages, eradicates the pathogens and is recognized disinfectant. So somewhere there are enough experimentation done in the whole scientific community. Next one, please. What is about the cow ghee? What are the scientific principles behind that? Oblations of the cow's ghee offered to the yajna fire purifies the atmosphere, spreads the pleasant fragments in it. The evil effects of all the chemically poisonous gases that are floating in the atmosphere due to severe pollution are nullified when yajna is performed with offering of cow's pure ghee. Gases produced by the burning of cow's pure ghee acts in balancing the cycle of nature. Cow's ghee is life, so says the Vedas. Ancient healers, medical practitioners, having known its wonderful healing properties, have given it a place of honor by describing it as medicine's medicine. Cow's ghee is the most unique matter, the nectar available to man or planet Earth. When cow's ghee is mixed with rice grains and uttering the mantras, Agnihotra oblations are offered to the fire. Four types of gases that are produced with the burning of oblations have been recognized so far. They are ethylene oxide, propylene oxide, formaldehyde, and butapropylactone. Now this is something which one has to really do. Now cow's ghee unfortunately got tarnished because somewhere we started believing the biggest rumor that the cholesterol is not good for the health. Almost for the last 40 years, the cholesterol has been heading the list of bad foods in America. And you would be surprised to know from 2015 June, the whole thing has shifted, the whole spectrum has shifted. Everything has gone topsy-turvy and cholesterol has been put on the top of the good food list in America, the government of America. Now somewhere I think we need to understand how those 40 years we kept on maligning the most wonderful, the medicines of the medicine that's cow's ghee, which Ayurveda actually works on. This is a core point. Let's go to the next one. After the oblations are offered to the fire, cow's ghee produces acetylene, the energy of excessive heat, which sucks in the polluted air and purifies it. The gases that are produced from the burning of the cow's ghee process, the wonderful capacity of removing mental tensions and curing many diseases. So some way that one need to really understand. In fact, there are enough experiments on that. If you light a cow's ghee lamp and looks at that for continuously for 5 minutes, it's a lot of eye diseases could be cured. So somewhere I think there are enough evidences about how the cow's ghee has really been useful to the human health. Let's go to the next one. How to perform? Check the local sunrise sunset timings from the annual timetable provided for performing Agnihotra. There are enough Agnihotra timetable sites on the internet today. Adjust your watch correctly as per the standard time. Arrange few pieces of dry cow dung cakes in Agnihotra, not about 5 to 10 minutes before the actual sunrise time. Okay, I'm just trying to take you through this whole system. Next one, please. First, take a small piece of the cow dung cake and place it at the bottom of the pot. Start arranging the other pieces of cow dung cakes around it neatly. Use a candle or the air to light the fire. Take 2 pinchfuls of clean unbroken rice grains on your left palm or in a small dish. Smear these rice grains with a few drops of cow's pure ghee. Divide the ghee smeared rice grains in two parts, you know, so that for two mantras you can offer these oblations. Next one, please. Now this is how the Agnihotra exactly works, the whole environment, you know, how it comes back. And there's a huge science, and you can look at the effect shoots up to 12 kilometers in the biosphere. And this has been proven time and again. And this is something not which is necessarily a myth to be believed or disbelieved. Okay, so let's go to the next one, please. The sun brings on or takes the energy which makes all conditions conducive to the anti-pollutionary change. It calms the world. The pyramid is the generator, the fire, the turbine. Just at morning Agnihotra, all the electricities, energies, ethers are attracted to the pyramid in its shape. At sunset, these energies are thrust out in the same shape. This flood of energies at sunrise creates strong purifying effects on all levels, wherever it touches the earth. Agnihotra amplifies these purifying effects in the following way. This flood of subtle energies carries music with it, the morning Agnihotra. So someday we need to understand how it happens. It is a combination of the mantras, the combination of the effect that is created over 12 kilometers. Next one, please. Mantra is the quintessential sound of the flood. If you then prepare the fire in the prescribed copper pyramid, utter these mantras, and offer the rice mixed with ghee to the fire, then channel is being created through the atmosphere and prana, the life energy is purified. When Agnihotra fire is burned, there is not just energy for the fire, the rhythms and mantras generate subtle energies which are thrust into atmosphere by fire. Also consider the quality of materials burned, wherein lies the full effect of this healing moment. Because all this is ash which is created. Yeah, so I'm just finishing within a couple of minutes. So all that which is remain. I mean, if you look at the whole thing, the Agnihotra ash which remains is called Vibhuti. Vibhuti means V plus Bhu plus T. V means something which is subtle. Bhu means the earth, and T means manifestation. So somewhere it is called Vibhuti because today it is called a miracle ash all over the Western world. Now this is something which opens a lot of possibilities, including cancer to be healed. This time is too short, just 20 minutes to talk about such a technology. But all that I wanted to impress upon, what is considered as a myth at one point of time, it is not about burning fire. It's a holy fire. And it's about yajna. It is not about the burning something. Okay, so I think I should stop here because probably my time is getting over. But as and when probably we get an opportunity, I'd be very happy to answer all your questions in whatever forum we can. So thank you very much for the patient listening. And thanks a lot. Have a good day.